everybody, this is Tracy here with another edition of A View from Tracy's Point, and we have an update in the R. Kelly case. And as you guys know, last week, I believe it was, Kim Fox, you know, they were getting ready to release all those documents from the Jesse Smollett case. So Kim Fox decided that she was going to drop 11 more charges on Mr. Kelly. And so we know it was just a cover up, because it seems like whenever she's about to be in the news, then she decides to go after him so he can overshadow. But I think people are kind of figuring out her little tactics. And the story really isn't getting all that much coverage anymore. But R. Kelly, the good news for him is that they did not seek an additional bond. Remember, he's already out on a $1 million bond for the 10 charges that were originally against him back in February. So they decided not to request an additional bond. So he was free to go. And the judge did remind him that, you know, he needs to appear at every single hearing. And he pointed out to him that if he does not appear at a hearing, that they could, I guess, move the case along to a trial and that a jury could render a verdict. I thought that was kind of interesting. So he was like, so please show up to all your hearings. And so I just thought that was so odd that he would say that. But I said, well, maybe he know that Kim Fox is really after this man, so he won't let him know. Like, let me give you a hint, brother, that you better be rolling up in this courtroom, because they got a whole bunch of tricks up their sleeve for you. I mean, that's just my speculation, not saying that that's what the judge was trying to insinuate in his instructions to Mr. Kelly. So he basically read off the charges, and that Kim Fox actually went back to the grand jury to get these new indictments on him, and she took new information. Now, you guys, check this out. Geronda Pace, crazy, went to these people and basically gave the same story as the Lenita Carter lady. And so this is what they have charged him with, that he forced her to have oral sex. And I'm just like, come on with the bullshit, y'all. Like, this is so crazy that they're doing this, but that's what these charges come from. Geronda claiming that he forced her to have oral sex. And I'm just like, girl, come on now. But you know, I don't want to say I can't wait until they cross-examine her, but I can't wait until they cross-examine Miss Geronda Pace. So that was the gist of the whole new charges. He did not have to pay any more money, and he was free to leave. And so they did stop Steve Greenberg after the hearing, and this is what he had to say.
Questions? I'm sorry. I'm losing my hearing.
Why do you think they're coming back with these new charges based on the same evidence?
Well, I can't speculate about why prosecutors do something. I deal with what they do. It's the same facts. The same question could be, why didn't they charge it originally, right? I don't know why. Maybe they're looking for leverage. Maybe they have some other evidence that we don't know about yet. But we expect we'll deal with it. It's the same facts that we know now, and it's the same witnesses, and we expect that it's going to be the same result. It's going to walk out the front door.
How concerned were you that the bond was going to be
revoked? I wasn't concerned. R. Kelly has complied with every single condition of bond. He's been perfect while he's out. He reports a pretrial like he's supposed to. He comes to court like he's supposed to, and there's no reason. Bond is to ensure that somebody appears in a court proceeding and for the safety of the public. He's not in danger of the public, and he appears in court. The trial to start? So the way it works here in Illinois, for the people who aren't from Illinois, so the prosecutors get to decide which case they want to do first. It's called an election. They haven't done that yet. At some point, they'll decide we want to do, let's say this case. We want to do this case, the JP case first. We'll then file motions on that case. We'll litigate that case. That's usually the way it works. The judge may set a different procedure in this case, but I expect it will be sometime next year at the earliest. There are still only four cases. So they get to decide, the prosecution gets to decide which case they want to do first. I'm Donna last night to beat the Warriors.
What do you guys expect? What's going to happen on the 26th?
That's a status date. I've been told that on the 26th they're going to be in a position to tender the video that's behind one of the cases. Maybe we'll get some more discovery. There's a ton of stuff we don't have yet.
What have you received so far?
We've received some police reports. We received a lot of reports of people calling in when Kim Fox made her outcry. None of those are cases, but they have to tender that in the course of discovery. But we haven't received any of the real scientific stuff, a couple of DNA reports, but none of the meat. We haven't received anything from the prior trial. We haven't received any of the reinvestigation, if they did any. We haven't received the emails, text messages. There's a litany of stuff we haven't received. A lot more than we have. I'm sorry, I can't. Right. So before we can get the tape, it's standard practice to enter into a protective order that says that we won't disseminate it for any reason. Obviously, if we wouldn't, that would be a crime. Didn't stop Avenatti from doing it, but I'm not going to do it. So we just got to be a protective order.
Stephen, you talked about the rumor that it's a federal indictment.
I've heard the rumors, but that's all. I don't expect anything. No. We have fine attorneys. Okay, no pun intended. We have, good attorneys here. We're all going to deal with the case as the case has come. If the feds indict Robert, then we'll deal with it. I don't know what they would possibly indict him on, but we'll deal. You can't speculate. You can't prepare for a case that's not there, and you can't try a case that's not there.
What's going on?
I.
No.
I think that they're working on that, and hopefully he'll be able to perform. I know he performed at a private party this past weekend. I'm not saying.
last night.
I'm sorry. How does the what work?
Pled not guilty. He pled, no, we pled not guilty to all of the charges because he's not guilty. No, it doesn't change the calculus at all. He didn't do it. I think he's feeling positive. It's tough. Everything is against him. I mean, imagine being in that position. It's contrary to every belief I have and we should all have. You're supposed to be presumed innocent. You should be able to make a living. You shouldn't have to deal with rumor and innuendo all the time. People should wait and let a case get decided in the court.
So he told reporters, we pled not guilty to all the charges because he's not guilty. And then he added that if you didn't do it, then you didn't do it. And I think he's feeling positive. It's tough. Everything is against him. And then Daryl seemed to still be holding on, but y'all didn't give Daryl too much camera time, right? So Daryl basically said that, you know, there was a moment when he was depressed. And anybody would be depressed if people are coming at you with these charges that could ruin your life. But he's gotten beyond that. He's feeling positive and that he is doing okay. And so, you know, basically with everything that he's dealing with, you know, he's okay. And then they asked Steve Greenberg about, you know, all these reports out here about a federal indictment. And he basically said, if the feds indict Robert, then we'll deal with it at that time. And I'm just really starting to look sideways at all this talk about these federal indictments that's going on. And I'm just wondering if it's just all orchestrated to basically get people scared and want to come talk and everything, because it's just too much going on. Because we know, as I said in the other video, the feds move in silence. They ain't out here talking to invest, like they're saying in these blogs, because I haven't seen any like real media outlets reporting on this, but in these blogs they're literally saying that investigators on the case are talking to the blogs and telling the blogs all this information. And my thing is, maybe the feds need to be in doing an internal investigation to find out who is out here talking to the media, because that's not how it works. And then I'm also starting to question what's really going on, because typically in a federal indictment, they're not calling in hundreds of witnesses. So according to the blogs, there's 200 witnesses testifying before the feds. There's all these whistleblowers, all these former employees. Now they're claiming that a whole bunch of tapes have been turned over to the FBI and also to Kim Fox's office. And just coming up with all kind of craziness that they're talking about. And I'm saying to myself, if Kim Fox, who hasn't even turned over the first videotape that she claimed she had, if y'all hadn't handed her a whole bunch of more tapes, wouldn't she have charged him again, like with and all this other stuff? Like, what is wrong with these people? So we still on Fed watch, y'all. Wait to see what's really going on with this whole situation, because I'm thinking it didn't take them no time to indict Michael Avenatti. Like, they didn't have to call in a whole bunch of witnesses. They had his bank records. I don't even know if they talked to the people that he had actually swindled. I mean, I'm sure they did, but I don't think it was like a long, drawn-out process. It was probably a five-minute conversation where they say, did this happen? And the people said, yes, this is what he was supposed to do, and this is what he told me, and that was the end of it. I don't know why the feds would be, like, conducting a full hearing, trying to convince a grand jury to indict someone when the reason they pull a grand jury together is because they know if they go to a judge, so a judge can order an indictment, or you can go before the federal, or you can go before the grand jury to get an indictment. It's harder to convince a judge to issue an indictment. That's why they go before the grand jury, because the grand jury, they just gonna hear the basic and say, yeah, this probably happened or it probably didn't happen, and that's the end of it. So the next thing I wanted to talk to you guys about was Angelo Clary. So I came across this article. I don't know if you guys, I had never heard of the Critics' Choice Reel Awards. Child, it was some award show took place over the weekend out in California, and I guess Surviving R. Kelly was nominated for an award. So the whole cast of characters flew out to Beverly Hills to attend this award show, and they were all excited. You know, they think they're celebrities now, y'all. They thought that they was royalty, okay? They got to walk the red carpet and all that good stuff.
You know, one of the things that I find particularly offensive is there was an award show this weekend, and the so-called victims are hooping and hollering. They're there with their parents, they're celebrating, and they're posting stuff on Facebook. This is a bunch of people who are going all over the country, getting wine and dine like they're some kind of heroes. They're not heroes. They're not heroes at all. And they're loving every minute of it. I've never seen supposed victims
and so, of course, the show won. I'm wondering how much did Lifetime actually pay these people to give them that award, because you know what they did, their follow-up R. Kelly show, it flopped big time, okay? Nobody watched that mess. I don't even think they got 500,000 viewers to watch that show. So they're trying, you know, and then they're trying to do the MTV Movie Awards, Movie and TV Awards. And people were, you know, campaigning, saying vote for anybody but the Surviving R. Kelly. But now that we see that they were able to get that Critics' Choice Awards, they're probably going to finagle their way into getting this MTV award as well. But anyway, so they interviewed Angelo Clary after the awards, and this is what Mr. Clary had to say. It says, the father of 21-year-old Azriel Clary spoke to Fox News on Sunday at the Critics' Choice Reel TV Awards about the massive void left behind by Azriel's absence, allegedly at the hands of rapper R. Kelly. Okay, R. Kelly is not a rapper, Fox News. He is an R&B. He is the king of R&B. And so, you know, basically Angelo told him that, you know, R. Kelly has Azriel brainwashed, and that, you know, he loves his daughter. He's going to do anything to get her back home. And so he says, you know, I haven't had time to speak to her, but as a father to another father, it's a feeling that you don't wish on anyone. It's a feeling that sometimes it's like having a deceased child, and the only thing you're waiting on is to find the body. Now, that was kind of... okay. He says, and you would hate to have to put things into perspective like that, but that's the emptiness you have on birthdays and holidays. And some of the most important things in your family occur, and you get no phone calls or texts or anything, but you keep texting the numbers you have in response to keeping an open communication going. Now, Angelo, just a few weeks ago, you were saying that your daughter, you done slipped her a burner phone, okay, and that she's been calling you and talking to you. So you need to make up your mind, sir, which one it is. Are you talking to your daughter, or are you not talking to your daughter? So the article goes on to say, Kelly's lawyer, Steve Greenberg, told Fox News of Clary's remarks, I think this is an individual who, for whatever reason, is going to milk this bad relationship with his daughter for as much personal benefit as he can. And then they go on to talk about Angelo saying that the open communication that he has with Azriel, or he assumes is Azriel, only occurs in text messages, and his feelings is that the person he is conversing with is someone other than Azriel. So I guess he's saying that R. Kelly over there with a damn phone sending him text messages pretending to be Azriel. Like, who has time for all that? Okay, make up your mind, Angelo. And so he says, well, 9 times out of 10, it's not her, but I know she's okay. I do all types of things as a father to make sure that she's at least living, breathing, and I can contest to say, okay, was she here? You know, I've seen her, so I've seen a picture of her of something like that. And then this didn't make any sense to me. So it says, I do the memes that I can without getting in trouble to get her attention. So I don't know if that was a typo or Fox trying to be funny, but basically, I guess he's saying that he'd be watching, he got somebody over there watching Trump Tower for Azrael come out the building. Because y'all know Steve Greenberg say that Azrael and Jocelyn, they come and go as they please. They don't have bodyguards and escorts. They do whatever they want to. They live in their life and they're happy. When asked about how he feels seeing other women share their harrowing experiences with the musician on the Lifetime docuseries Surviving R. Kelly, or watching Kelly's outburst during his interview with CBS Gayle King, Clary said he believes Kelly simply didn't have anyone around him to alert him of his alleged actions and with girls, and that Kelly has so many people around him telling him that things are okay or that what he's doing is okay. Then he goes on to say, you have so much corruption going on around him to protect their own secret hidden agendas and past that, you know, why should he feel like he's doing anything wrong? So Clary speculated it's nothing any different than what he'd been doing 20 to 30 years ago. Me as a father watching it, it did show me that no matter what anybody can say to me on the internet or anything, nobody can beat me down more than I beat myself down, because I had a choice and the chance to change the whole situation. So is he kind of like feeling guilty that he was the one that took his daughter to this man, tried to pursue a singing career, and it didn't turn out the way he was hoping? And they point out, you know, when Azrael was being interviewed by Gayle King, you know, that she says that, you know, her dad is very manipulative and that he's the one that you need to watch out for. And she alleged that Angelo threatened to expose new photos of her online if she didn't have Kelly send him thousands of dollars to his bank account. And then they went on to say that Angelo and Alice denied the claims that Azrael had made. And then he went live on his Instagram from the actual dinner, the award ceremony. And so people were asking him in the comments, like, where's your wife? Where's your wife? Where's your wife? And I don't know if I've talked about this before, but I believe that Angelo and Azrael's mom are not married. Because it seemed like I read somewhere a while ago that they actually got a divorce in 2007, maybe. So they haven't been together for a really long time. But he would never answer that question, like, where's Alice? Where's your wife? Why isn't she there with you? And so she has been extremely quiet lately. We don't hear a peep from her anymore. And so he was there, and he appeared to be sitting at the table with Ashanti and Lisa Van Allen and Kitty Jones and all the rest of them. And so he goes on to say, I believe that my daughter and her gift led me on a different path to allow me to trust someone that I shouldn't have put that much trust into. So every day I got to live with that. I live with that for my family, for my kids, and for all the other kids that didn't have a father there, that I become their voice now. You know, I take responsibility for that. And so Clary said he certainly keeps up with the legal proceedings surrounding the Kelly case and has even spoken with many of the alleged victims, the younger victims, the kids, and the teenagers that have no choice in this matter. Angelo, what kids? What teenagers? Who are all these people? Because they're the ones that say that there's like 200 victims that's talking to the feds. So I don't know, but let's keep going with this article. So he says, I just feel like any man that messes with a child is less than a man. And they can say it's a sickness, it's this. Well, when is somebody going to step up and get him some help? When are we going to stop saying he's sick, he's this, he's that? That's my whole thing. As for the outcome that he hopes that R. Kelly will get, Clary said he only wants justice for his daughter and to see other women released from him, away from him, and starting their own lives, and for Kelly to just become a regular guy. I don't really care about 100 years in prison, 20 years in prison, a year in prison. I want to strip him of what made him, said Clary. I want to send him back to being in the subway singing to a crowd, because that's the most devastating punishment he will have to live with, stripping him of everything that made him who he is. I want to make him bank robber. That's what I want to do. So what do y'all think about that? That Angelo say he doesn't want R. Kelly to go to jail. He just wants him to lose all his material possessions and I guess to be humbled in this whole situation. Let me know. Leave your comments below. Rate the video and subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. And until the next time, I shall talk to you guys later. Bye-bye.